Hello everyone, welcome to the lecture on globalization and literature. This lecture is part of your paper on media and globalization. In this lecture, we will learn about world literature, which under globalization illustrates both identity and migration of ideas in a digital space, which today inhabits fluid geography in the world of letters. Introduction. Globalization is the integration of social, political, cultural, and economic forces in a neoliberal world order governed basically by capitalism. Globalization has different connotations in different spheres, motivated mainly by economic forces. But as far as literature is concerned, never before in the history of the world has there been such rapid transfer of stories to such a far-flung group of readers. With instant messaging platforms, the craze phase for certain stories is a phenomenon unseen in the pre-globalized world. Who can forget the copies of the final Harry Potter that were airdropped in the remote Australian outback? Even more rapid is the movement of stories on the World Wide Web, which has made physical barriers irrelevant. The cost of reading on digital devices such as the Kindle have made reading the latest in world fiction an immediate pleasure, much more affordable than in previous times. World literature, in terms of reach, has never been in a more exciting and dynamic space, and the dissemination of stories across cultures has never been easier. How much the scenario has changed even in the last 15 years since the publishing of Iranian author Azar Nafisi's book Reading Lolita in Tehran. It is a luminous tale set against the Iran-Iraq war. It has in the back foreground the deepening of consciousness that results from the reading of great and in Iran of the time forbidden world literature. In this lecture, you will learn how stories travel and thus imbue literature with the power to preserve and share knowledge about a historical time. An unfamiliar people and culture, but in an enjoyable and accessible way. In fact, accessible in the globalized world is the key word, for the speed with which books reach us today are just a click away. Literature is said to mirror society, and since the gamut of human emotions, love, greed, hate, lust, etc., remain common threads in all great literature, no matter the nationality of the author, it is in this context we examine both the impact and relevance of globalization on storytelling. Globalization helps us learn easily about alien cultures and conflicts, and helps us belong to another time, another place, without being disconnected from a larger interlinked world. The pre-print era. We will first examine how stories traveled across languages and boundaries, as well as continued to endure with time. We begin with the looming shadow cast across all Western literature by Homer's oral classic, the Greek epics, Odyssey and Iliad. Even today, they make up the curriculum of literature studies in all great universities, despite being conceived by a blind poet around the 8th century BC. Such is their influence down the centuries that they have impacted the work of even authors of recent vintage, right up to Margaret Atwood in her novella, The Penelopiad. A better known example would be the Irish author James Joyce. Here, the reader will find that Ulysses wanders the streets of Dublin albeit in an ironical vein. Further away from Greece in terms of distance and culture is Homer's unmistakably inspiring place in the long novel Omeros, written by the Nobel Prize winning Caribbean poet Derek Walcott. Omeros, a book of great beauty that captures the essence and fragrance of the Caribbean, whilst at the same time the link to Homer's Iliad, the story with far greater resonance and depth. The Indian epics, the Mahabharata and the Ramayana, were unlikely to have been influenced by the Hellenic epics. Their reach is not as far-flung as Homer's works, but their impact in art and literature is visible as far as Bali in Indonesia, where characters from these epics inspire sculptors and theater artists even today. Within India, both these epics have a very unifying influence. In the globalized present, playwright Peter Brook's Mahabharata is a celebrated adaptation of the Indian epic, although the Kavya format in which the great epic was written is not adequately conveyed. While the multicultural cast is testimony to the global appeal of the epic, it must be said that sometimes the ethos can be lost in translation, as in this case. Peter Brook's and a scene from his The Mahabharata. Globalization and the printed book. Books were earlier fragile, precious objects handwritten on parchment, vellum, or painstakingly on tablets of stone or bronze. These were often lost to war and neglect. All this changed with the invention of the Gutenberg press around the 1440. Of course, the first book to be mass-produced was the Bible, and globalization and religion might be an interesting spin-off to this discussion. However, in the Indian context, apart from the epics, only a few authors, such as Tagore, traveled to other shores with their work before independence. Until 1991, India was isolated in a protected economy to give its fledging units after the independence a chance to become self-reliant. The middle class rarely travelled overseas, and exchange of stories was usually one way. The small English-educated upper middle classes reading British classics, Hardy and Eliot and Shakespeare. Cheap paperbacks of writers such as Agatha Christie and P.G. Woodhouse were universally popular, but the choice in reading matter was very limited. Authors from the UK were most widely read as part of the still existing colonial heritage of centuries of British rule. So we have at least three generations of children educated in the English medium, growing up on the stories of Enid Blyton, reading about things they could not connect to, such as Haiti and Guy Fawkes. Similarly, the great continent of Africa was dominated for centuries by slavery, war, and exploitation. Joseph Conrad's much-celebrated Heart of Darkness, when seen from African eyes, can appear racially prejudiced. Edward Said's Orientalism, a strong treatise against this prejudice, and sometimes romanticized depiction of lands and cultures by their colonial masters. Today, writers from the Niger Delta, with a history of colonial education similar to India, are finding their voices and their own interpretation of the continent's history, often propelled to greater success and fame due to the international literary awards which they have been feted with. Chinua Achebe, Wol Soyinka, Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie, and Ben Oriare, obvious authors to read, all writing in English, to name but a few. Between them, they have received the Nobel Prize, Bailey's, Commonwealth, and Man Booker, brought events of great humanitarian crisis such as Biafran's Civil War to the knowledge of the globalized world. However, unlike in India, not many native Africans are consuming fiction, and publishing is nowhere as robust as in India. In fact, globalization in Africa has taken on a new identity, that of exploitation by multinationals. Yet, the literature continues to be dominated by matters of class, conflict, race, and gender. Globalization has certainly unshackled the tongues of women and included at least the concept of feminism in oppressed societies. As in India too, women's voices are being heard through the stories they tell, coupled with the fact that such stories resonate with women readers, who at least in India make up the bulk of the buyers for books. Perhaps literature and globalization have succeeded better in countries that were originally colonized, part of empire, because undoubtedly English is the language of globalization. Transfer of ideas, as with books, has been swift in countries proficient in English, be it Nigeria or the Indian subcontinent. Indian authors were far more widely read the world over than, say, until very recently, Chinese or Korean authors. And it is only recently that books like Han Kang's The Vegetarian reached other countries, despite the author being widely appreciated at home. And even here, the credit for winning the Booker has been equally shared by her translator. Salman Rushdie's Midnight's Children was a most important novel in bringing to world focus a momentous turning point in Indian history in a very sophisticated style of magical realism. It was recognized by receiving the Booker of Bookers, amongst other awards. Surprising that independence and partition, recorded as the largest migration in history, had not garnered any attention in literature before Midnight's Children published, more than 3 decades after partition. Salman Rushdie belonged to both India and the West, a childhood spent in India and further studies in the UK. The bulk of Indian authors to follow in his footsteps likewise straddled two worlds. The list includes Rohinton Mistry, Vikram Chandra, Suketu Mehta, Jhumpa Lahiri, Anita and Kiran Desai. Vikram Seth too was living in the West when Golden Gate was published. Other authors born in the subcontinent, such as Kamila Shamshi, Tamina Anam, and Michael Ondaatje, have a similar East-West link. Arundhati Roy was the only author to live in India and enjoy international acclaim to a major degree. It can be summarized that migration being such an important facet of globalization itself meant that a migrant's perspective was the link which joined Indian stories to the body of the world literature. Sadly, this has excluded many great works written in regional languages. In fact, it's a matter of debate whether the world novel does not take away from the richness of more intimate and regional stories. Of course, it must be remembered that the process of globalization is an ongoing one, and the situation is a constantly changing one. The future is definitely going to see a greater homogenization of stories as cultures assimilate each other. It is already happening in the developed West. Translated works are hopefully expected to gain in importance as access to translators through the digital process is easier than ever before. Since in many spheres the benefit of globalization have been found to be unequal, it is hoped this lacunae in audiences for regional authors can be mitigated. This view was first explained by author and philosopher Goethe, who expounded that world literature and not national literature was the future way back in the 19th century. Goethe's definition has been reinforced by many and quite recently by Venkatmani in his essay about world literature. Professor Gayatri Chakravarti Spivak, however, disagrees and feels an original work loses much of its rootedness to a region in an attempt to reach out to the world reader through translation. This is in line with her important body of work focusing on those whose creative output has been marginalized by Western culture. The jury is still out on this important debate. The role of globalization in the structure of stories. Now, how globalization itself enters into the narrative of contemporary literature and impacts the protagonist's life. Here, the novels deny Professor Roland Robertson's theory of the world as a single compressed whole, where movement of ideas is such that globalization results in the world being perceived as a unified one, aided by improved communication and economic exchanges. The protagonist, Changez, in The Reluctant Fundamentalist, written by Mohsin Hamid, is living the American dream studying in Princeton when 9/11 happens. Changez finds himself smiling as the Twin Towers topple. It is a telling moment when the cultural divide becomes apparent. His world falls apart as he feels defined by the color of his skin and the prejudice and suspicion with which he is viewed. The theory of globalization also denies the place of history in the structure of a migrant's life, since it is a theory that chooses to look forward, sometimes ignoring the lessons that history affords one. Similarly, Kiran Desai's Booker Prize winning novel, The Inheritance of Loss, also has characters that face an identity crisis after migrating to the West. It explores the darker side of globalization, bitterness at the racial prejudice and exploitation, as well as class divisions at home. In fact, one man's wealth results in another man's poverty. It drives home the fact that greatly improved technology still leaves millions of people in a very deprived state. Desai confirms exploitation and racial prejudice are not phenomena that can be solved by the wand of globalization. Globalization is also the period against which two of the Nigerian authors Chimamanda Adichie's novels Purple Hibiscus and Half of a Yellow Sun are set. The terrible unrest and civil war in Nigeria is accompanied by the destruction of the fabric of family life and old-fashioned expectations of the protagonists as new ideas are transmitted into a changing world. Rushdie's characters are more optimistic in both Moore's Last Sigh and Midnight's Children. The characters tend to overcome challenges and shape lives around them rather than become victims or bystanders of globalizing forces, such as in Amitav Ghosh's Ibis trilogy. The rise of e-commerce with globalization. No coincidence that back in 1995, when Amazon was setting up its e-commerce business, it chose books to begin with. Books did not need to be tried on for fit or counter-checked for quality of fabric used and so forth. It was also easy to load on a blurb from the book jacket as a means of attracting a reader. An early success saw many copycat spin-offs, including our very own Flipkart. Today, Amazon's e-books have outstripped demand for physical books. Books are slotted into categories like historical, thriller, literature, etc. for a reader's convenience. However, genres which are complex and cannot be neatly categorized may resent this mass commercialization. In this world of multitasking, a positive spin-off has been the availability of audiobooks. Thousands of commuters devour fiction on headphones whilst driving to work or jogging in the park or commuting during the night. Poetry read in the voices of famous actors truly improves its lyrical appeal. All these new formats of absorbing literature are spin-offs of globalization. Criticism of this explosion of availability is that authors are less protected by copyright, and copyright itself has become a multi-jurisdictional subject, as physical boundaries between countries have become irrelevant in this digital world. Indeed, digital marketing is a cultural juggernaut that crushes small publishers and independent bookshops in its wake. Amazon's own system of reviewing books is also subjective based on reader feedback. Authors with large social media following who are capable of pushing their book online or are celebrities but not necessarily very good writers are moving center stage. It's all about quantity over quality for sales today. So while the reader has a bewildering array of world literature at cheaper prices to choose from, the image of the old reclusive author only concerned with narrative and world is dead. As is the value of the erudite and learned book reviewer whose print reviews could make a quick reprint of a fresh edition possible. Book bloggers who merely Instagram book covers are gaining power instead. Today, the author must market his own personality, intersperse his work with digital content, sparkle constantly online. In the words, the marketing of the book could consume an author more than the writing of it. It's a new reality of globalization and not the most positive aspect as the concerning literature. Conclusion. There are three aspects that we have examined in globalization and literature. We have touched upon literature in history, the transmitting of epics like Iliad and Mahabharata through oral tradition, in the tongues of traders and soldiers, and the international concept of a central heroic figure. That was the preprint age. From the print period, we examined the role of translations in bringing great stories penned in alien tongues, as well as the relevance of everyday people becoming central figures in stories rather than the larger-than-life characters of the greater epics. In the Indian context, the role of the diasporic author and the rise of Indian writing in the 90s will be a point of focus. Since globalization implies the shrinking of a world order and the transmission of ideas, finance, goods, and stories across physical boundaries to the digital media, it leads to a change in cultural connects. Surely, as the empire writes back, erstwhile colonizing nations look at regions they once exploited with a fresh vision. These nations are now writing their own stories, reaching out for a fresh understanding from readers as they are lauded for their contribution to the world literature. For more details, please read the e-text of this literature properly and attempt the questions in the end. Thank you.